The respiratory system involves the movement of air from the atmosphere into your body so that your lungs can transfer the oxygen from that air into your blood. It also allows CO2 to be removed from your blood so that your body can expel it. We need oxygen so that our cells can function. It's a crucial molecule in producing ATP. ATP is needed for all the different types of reactions that occur in our cells. At certain times, the cells in our body require more oxygen, so our body compensates by changing respiration, meaning how often and how much air we breathe in. Here is what we will be looking at today: the main functions of the respiratory system, the anatomy of the respiratory system, external respiration, or how gases are exchanged between our bodies and the atmosphere, and internal respiration, or how oxygen and carbon dioxide are exchanged between the blood and the cells in our tissues. So to start off, let's first take a look at what the respiratory system does. It provides a large surface area for gas exchange. It provides protection from any drying out or dehydration of the respiratory surfaces. Provides defense against pathogens that get into our system. It helps to produce sounds like speech or singing. And it helps in the sense of smell. There are olfactory receptors for smell in your nasal cavity. Okay, so let's dive into the upper respiratory system. The upper respiratory system consists of the nose, nasal cavity, sinuses, and the pharynx. What these structures help to do is filter, warm, and humidify incoming air. This helps to protect the more delicate surfaces of the lower respiratory system. The upper respiratory system also helps to reabsorb heat as well as water from the air that is expelled from our lungs. If we take a look at the pharynx, you can see that it is divided up into three different areas: the nasopharynx, the oropharynx, and the laryngopharynx. The nasopharynx is the superior portion of the pharynx seen here. The oropharynx is located between the soft palate and the bottom part or the base of the tongue. And the laryngopharynx extends until the entrances of the larynx and esophagus. The lower respiratory system consists of the larynx, trachea, bronchi, bronchioles, smallest bronchioles, and the alveoli. These structures allow for gases to be exchanged from the lungs to the blood and vice versa. Air enters the trachea and flows downwardly. The trachea is surrounded by approximately 20 cartilages that provide stiffness to the tracheal walls. This is for protection of your windpipe. So as air descends down the trachea, it travels towards two large tubes that are called the primary bronchi. There is a right and left primary bronchus. What's interesting here is that the right bronchus has a greater diameter and is situated at a much steeper angle than the left bronchus. So when someone accidentally aspirates an object that enters the trachea, often that object will enter the right bronchus. As the air we inspire continues through the respiratory tract, it enters smaller bronchi and eventually the bronchioles. Bronchioles are extremely interesting because they have the ability to increase and decrease their diameter. This is accomplished by thick layers of smooth muscle in the walls of the bronchioles. The increase in diameter is called bronchodilation, and the decrease is called bronchoconstriction. So, eventually air reaches the alveoli. This is where gas exchange takes place. Alveoli are clusters of air sacs that look like bunches of grapes. They allow for oxygen to get into our blood and for carbon dioxide to leave the blood. The oxygen is then transported to our tissues that require the oxygen to make ATP, and the CO2 is transferred and expelled out of our system and into the atmosphere. Within the lungs, there is an immense amount of vascularity. This allows for oxygen to enter the blood and oxygenate it, while allowing the blood to unload carbon dioxide. In this diagram, you can see a close-up of an alveolus and a pulmonary capillary. The areas of exchange in the lungs contain very, very thin membranes. The reason for this is that it makes diffusion distances for oxygen and carbon dioxide much shorter, and thus easier. As you can see, oxygen moves from the alveolar airspace into a pulmonary capillary and then into a red blood cell, which is what is used to carry oxygen within our blood. At the same time, carbon dioxide moves out of the red blood cell, through the pulmonary capillary, and into the alveolar airspace. When we exhale, the CO2 moves up the respiratory tract and out of our mouths into the surrounding atmosphere.